Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, curator, distinguished professor of U.S. military history at Missouri University of Science and Technology. And I'd like to welcome my co-host, April Cheek Messier, the president and CEO of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation, and of course, John Long, director of education. Welcome both of you.
Hi, John. Good to see you again. Or
too.
Hear you.
Thank you, John. Great to be back.
Yeah, great to have you. We have such an honor today to have Alex Kershaw on with us. Alex has authored 11 books. I like to think that we are sort of kindred spirits in our tremendous passion for telling the story of Allied soldiers, and especially American soldiers, I think. And Alex has, is a veteran historian who has conducted many battlefield tours for the National World War II Museum, been a featured speaker all over the place. And of course, among his many books was one called The Liberator that was recently made into a miniseries on Netflix. Alex is a storyteller who has few peers. And Alex, I just wanted to thank you so much for joining us today. I've been excited about this, and it's a real honor to have you.
It's great to be here.
Yeah, so of course, what we want to focus on today is your brand new book, which is called Against All Odds, A True Story of Ultimate Courage and Survival in World War II. And so, the first, I think, most natural question that I have for you, you chose four individuals to focus on in the book. Maurice Britt, Michael Daly, Keith Ware, and of course, the very famous Audie Murphy. So why these four?
Well, I should back up a little bit and say that the reason why I did the book in the first place was because I became fascinated with Medal of Honor recipients in World War II. And I came across the fact that the 3rd ID had received more, 3rd Infantry Division has received more Medals of Honor than any other division. So I think, and I have to be very cautious here because John, Dr. John is interrogating me here. So anything I say is immediately going to be, if I get something wrong, only one person in the room is going to know exactly how wrong I am, but it's going to be John. So
We'll referee.
John, please jump in whenever you can, because sometimes I need to be massively fact-checked. But anyway, I think there was something like 90 divisions in Europe, American infantry divisions in Europe at the end of the war. 3rd ID was one of them. And they had received, I believe, during the war, 36 Medals of Honor, 4 after the war. And that was far more than any other U.S. infantry division in the European theater. John's written about the 7th Infantry Regiment at great length, so he's intimately aware of a lot of the different chapters in my book from a slightly different perspective, but probably, one of the finest living historians of that division and that wonderful infantry regiment. So anyway, I was amazed by that. How come one infantry division out of 90 could amass almost a tenth of all the medals of honor awarded in World War II? So I think there were something like 470 medals altogether, and they have today officially, I think it's 40. So I thought to myself, how the hell did they manage that? When you look at it, 101st Airborne, Glamour Boys, Screaming Eagles, we all know that they won World War II single-handedly. A little bit of help from Tom Hanks and a few others, but
right, of course
they have two. Am I right, John? I think they have two recipients from World War II, and then you look at the 3rd ID with 40, and you think to yourself, what the heck happened here? Well, the answer is pretty simple. The 3rd ID spent longest in combat in World War II in the European theater, highest number of fatalities, very high turnover in troops, and fought longest to liberate Europe in World War II. So they were just in a hell of a lot of very fierce battles all the way through and had many, many opportunities to be super heroic. And that's why they have so many Medal of Honor recipients. So my fascination was with the Medal of Honor, first of all, and then I wanted to try and tell a story of what it took to what kind of man can not win but earn the Medal of Honor, what qualities they had as human beings, as warriors, and also to tell the story of the liberation of Europe from beginning to end through these key characters that I chose. And I'll be honest with you, I cherry-picked them. I initially wanted them all to intercross. I wanted them to know each other, or, you know, ideally fight shoulder to shoulder. And they did intersect. Their lives did intersect, certainly after the war and during the war. Three of the four all fought in the same infantry regiment, the 15th. So I just cherry-picked the guys that I thought were most interesting, most compelling, and that moved me most. Their lives after the war were the most moving to me. It was a very selfish project, I have to say. I just wanted to tell a hell of a war story about incredible warriors.
And Alex, for our readers, obviously, this is such an amazing book, and to hear these stories and their individual stories come to life, you bring them to life for us. Can you just quickly tell us a little bit about each of them? Just something that they're going to, people will be reading if they have not read the book yet.
Well, I start with Morris Britt, who's from Arkansas, played for the Detroit Lions, fantastic athlete, star of the Razorbacks at the University of Arkansas. He was with the 30th Infantry Regiment, landed in North Africa in November 1942. So that's the first time that Americans began to kill and die to liberate a place that I love almost as much as this country, because I'm, as you can tell, I'm a Limey, but I've been here half my life. And I followed Britt all the way through to Anzio. He had his arm blown off at Anzio, height of the battle there, and was brought back to the US. Miraculous that he lived, and became really a kind of iconic figure, a willing participant in propaganda campaigns that, you know, I use the word propaganda in the right sense of the word. He was raising money for war bonds, etc., and had the distinction of being the first American in World War II to gain every medal that you could receive in World War II. So there weren't as many medals that you could receive in World War I, but in World War II he had the Bronze Star, Silver Star, DSC, and the Medal of Honor. So that made him pretty special. And the fact that he was a star athlete, you know, NFL player, very handsome, very articulate, made him a bit of a superstar. Quickly, I chose Audie Murphy because I love the guy. He's a superhero to me, very interesting human being, a lot more complex, I think, than most people realize. And because I wanted to have a recognizable star for readers to attach to. There was a little bit of a commercial interest there, but also I've always loved Audie Murphy. Third character is Keith Ware. He's actually started off the war in Sicily. He was actually Audie Murphy's company commander on the 10th of July, 1943. So that's B Company Commander, 10th of July, 1943, 15th Infantry Regiment. That's Keith Ware. And he has the distinction of being the only draftee to become a general officer in U.S. military history. And I'm waiting for someone to pounce on me there, to fact check me there. But that means that he hadn't been in the National Guard. He hadn't had any prior military service, and went from literally being a pen pusher in California all the way to being a general officer. And to date, he's the only guy that's ever achieved that. Knew Audie Murphy really well after the war, was his commanding officer throughout the war in some respect, in the sense that he was B Company commander and then rose through the ranks to become a lieutenant colonel. Audie Murphy was under his command. Finally, but this is most pertinent to you, April, I chose Michael Daly, whose first day of combat was Omaha Beach for D-Day. Dr. John knows very much, a hell of a lot more than me about the big red one that landed on Omaha. And Michael Daly was in the 18th Infantry Regiment, and that's he came ashore, I think, about 1:30 in the afternoon. Still very dangerous at 1:30 in the afternoon. He was under intense machine gun fire, and he went all the way to Nuremberg. Was wounded, received the Silver Star in Normandy, broke out, wounded near Aachen, that very bloody introduction for Americans to just how fierce the Nazis would fight for their own soil. Became Alexander Patch's aide, unofficial aide. Patch was the 7th Army commander, really a wonderful, wonderful army commander, very underappreciated, I believe, a tragic story. And then Michael Daly said, you know, I'm not going to be your driver. I'm not going to be behind the lines. I want to go back into combat. I want to lead men in combat. And at the age of 20, got his wish, was sent into the 15th Infantry Regiment, where Audie Murphy and Keith Ware were fighting, just in time to experience some of the worst combat of the Battle of the Colmar Pocket. And Michael Daly was received the medal for actions he performed on the 17th of April 1945 amid the ruins of Nuremberg in very intense street fighting. I think he took out 3 or 4 machine gun nests, almost, this is a kind of oxymoron, but almost fatally wounded the next day, shot through the face from one side to the other, given last rites. It was something of a miracle he got to Nuremberg, given his actions all the way through the war, but definitely a miracle that he survived, came home, went back to Connecticut, and we can talk about their lives after the war later. But I loved all four men. They were remarkable spirits. They were exceptional leaders. And I think the one thing that defined all of them that I admired most, they were utterly selfless. They were more than prepared. They were prepared at any second of that massive ordeal to lay down their lives for others. And their actions showed that they were absolutely prepared to do that.
Alex, for listeners who may not be familiar, describe the process by which the Medal of Honor was awarded in World War II.
Well, it's a great question, because it's interesting, because without veering off subject too much, you know, John and I can have this discussion later on about the number of medals of honor given out for actions, let's say, on Omaha Beach. It's a really good discussion subject for later on. But it's a, you know, the medal, you have to have eyewitnesses. You have to have superior officers make recommendations. It's a congressional medal of honor. It's a formal process. It's you have to tick all the boxes. Crucially, there have to be eyewitnesses. And there are many occasions in World War II, certainly on Omaha Beach is a perfect example, where many men performed actions for which they should have received the Medal of Honor. Had they been seen, had they been alive, had there been an officer around to witness it. So you look at the Bedford Boys. A Company, you know, I would have given half those guys at the Medal of Honor. I'm sorry, but, you know, I would have, you know, certainly the ones that went on to not only cross that beach, but then somehow miraculously come home. All along that beach that day, there were many cases that of men who died or weren't seen. There were no eyewitnesses. And I think, John, there were only three. You can correct me, only three.
Yeah, there are three from Omaha Beach.
Omaha Beach.
When you're right, Alex. It's really a microcosm.
Yeah, and you know, yeah, totally. And you think that over 900 Americans killed on Omaha Beach. If there's a single day when you have more concentrated heroism in the European theater, I'd like to know about one if you're an American, certainly on Omaha. And sure. The fact that there's only three is, number one, ridiculous. And number two, totally unjust, because there were cases where guys who were recommended for the medal, several guys were recommended for the medal, where the medal was downgraded to a DSC. Now, the one guy, John will know this, who's the guy that received it posthumously, that was at the far.
Yeah, it almost happened to Jimmy Monteith. Monteith, they wanted to downgrade him.
Yeah, Monteith's a perfect example. Yeah. Eisenhower, Allied Chief Supreme Commander, has to step in. I'm sorry, but this pisses me off. Can I use that? Can I say this? This stresses me greatly. That you have a guy that the Allied Supreme Commander has to step in to make sure that this guy is recognized. And I've been to his grave and gives his life. And you know, was going to end up with a DSC, so Ike has to step in and make sure he gets recognized properly. So anyway.
And he reminds me a lot of Ware in your book too, the way he, Monteith really showed the men what to do. He led the way. He was that example. You're absolutely right.
Yeah, totally. I think that I looked at a lot of the situations where guys in the third ID received the medal, and there were two factors that kind of interested me. I don't think we can make a rule out of them, but I would really be interested in talking to John about this because he might be able to add to this. But I found that on key days where very important things had to happen, so the breakout of Anzio with the third ID, you know, very, very important action. We had to get off that stalemate, that bloody battlefield. Over 900, I believe, 932 guys from the third ID lost their lives on one day in May of 1944. That's the largest number of Americans killed from one division in World War II. Again, John can add to that.
So,
yeah, exactly. So I looked at that day, and funnily enough, on key days, more men received the medal, not just because it was, I believe, because it was a highly violent episode, but because the significance of their actions was recognized by guys above them. So, you know, we're not just taking any hill here, we're taking a very important hill, or this battle is very crucial. There was a lot more attention paid to those actions. And the other thing that I came across was that apart from guys going so-called gun crazy, where they just were insane with rage or grief or any combination of awesome emotions, a lot of the time it just came down to someone's going to have to do this job right now, or we're all going to get killed, or a lot of my men are going to get killed, and I'm going to do it. And they just made that split decision. Someone has to do something. Someone has to put their head above the parapet. Someone has to take that tank out. Someone has to move forward. And that in all the cases that I write about, was the fact. They did it because they knew someone had to get the job done.
Yeah, well, you know, another person whom you talked about who's not one of the four, but who I know you knew well and was very intriguing to me as historian of the 7th Infantry Regiment is Bob Maxwell.
Oh, yeah. Have you met Bob, John?
I never met him personally.
Oh, okay, right.
And so I'm very envious that you did. And so I'm curious to hear more about your experience with Bob Maxwell, because you share some of that in the book too, of how he fits together with the story of the other four you're telling.
Yeah, well, Bob, I went to see, when I was starting to research the book, I crazily went out to Oregon to see Bob Maxwell. And part of it was kind of a little bit of trophy hunting, to be honest, you know, because I, you know, you don't collect veterans, but you do feel really proud when you've met someone who's been in a certain battle and played a big role, whether officers or somebody else. And I had never met in person such a religious Medal of Honor recipient. I've only met two Medal of Honor recipients from World War II, interviewed a fair few, but I went out to Oregon and I met Bob Maxwell. He was 98 at the time, and he was the oldest living Medal of Honor recipient then. That was December 2019. And there were, I think, at the time, there were only four or five guys left. He was the oldest living one. And as John was saying, belonged to the regiment that he's written so well about. And his case was, you know, he received the medal for actions in Besançon, central eastern France, in September of 1944. And his is a perfect example of what happened when many guys performed these actions. And that was a grenade bounced off some chicken wire near him, and he smothered it with a blanket and his body. And he told me that it was a completely instinctual reaction, that he didn't even think about it. He didn't make any decision. He just jumped on the grenade. And that's badly wounded. And that's the action for which he received the medal. And he didn't set out to be a hero. He said, none of us did. We were just trying to stay alive. He said that he prayed almost every second that he was awake. He mumbled prayers when he wasn't openly praying. Very religious guy, convinced that the only reason he came back was because of God. And said, I when he wore the medal for me and he took some persuading, he said, "This medal's weighed pretty heavy on me all my life. I didn't set out to be a superhero. I certainly am not, don't regard myself as a superhero. And there were a hell of a lot of guys out there who were lying under white crosses that deserved the medal much more than I did." Yeah, so he was amazing. Bob Bexall was a really beautiful human being.
You know, Alex, just to kind of feed off what you're saying there, there's toward the end of the book, you do describe a meeting between Michael Daly and Bob Maxwell, and another Medal of Honor recipient, obviously, to dedicate a cemetery. And you write, "The two were photographed amid perfect rows of white crosses. Both understood the pressures that came with receiving the Medal of Honor. They were held to a higher standard than other veterans, but they hadn't chosen to earn the ultimate prize. They didn't want to be put on a pedestal." Talk a little bit about, for them, that weight, that burden that was really put on them, you know, because you really had to almost this pressure to live this perfect life after.
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, Bob Maxwell said to me that we are held to a different standard. And, you know, maybe we should be held to a different standard because we are. That medal represents to him and Michael Daly, the medal did not represent their own heroism. They both stressed that they wore the medal with pride because it stood for the guys they'd fought with, the unit they'd fought with. It was something that they realized that brought attention to them and therefore the people they had fought with and the people who had died when they were in people who had died when they were in combat with. But yeah, you know, you can't get divorced. You can't be drunk in public. You can't commit any kind of felony. You have to be perfect. And, it's going to be a local news story if Bob Maxwell was taught mechanics, car mechanics in his local community college for, I think, 30 years. He's just an ordinary guy. He wanted a simple life. He had a very righteous life, very, very honest guy, worked very hard all of his life. And, you know, I kind of got the impression that he just wanted to be left alone most of the time, but would perform his duty when called out to be the local Medal of Honor guy, you know? But yeah, I don't think I think it made him uncomfortable. And I think that Michael Daly certainly felt very uncomfortable for quite a long time. He drifted after he came back from the war. He had PTSD. He was a bit of a heavy drinker. Quite directionless. And there's a really lovely photograph in the book that I found of him coming back to, I believe it's Fairfield, Connecticut, after he'd received the medal in the White House. And I think that was late August 1945, just a couple of weeks after we dropped the bombs on Japan. And the largest number of recipients of the Medal of Honor ever gathered were in the White House to receive it from Truman. And the very next day, Michael Daly was in a car, open-top car, coming back to this big fanfare in his hometown. And beside him was his father. So Michael Daly's father was a regimental commander in World War II, and I believe that the only medal that he hadn't received in his career was the Medal of Honor. And Michael Daly later was interviewed, and he said that he wished that day when he returned home as the local superhero that his father had been wearing the medal and not him. And that says a lot. It says basically that he didn't want the public recognition, and he also believed that his father, well, he hero worshipped his father, but he believed that his father had spent a lot more time in combat and it would have been great to see his father wear it because he didn't want it.
Alex, obviously you celebrate the heroism of these four men and rightfully so. But your book certainly doesn't glorify the combat in which they achieved their fame. How hard is it to find that balance as an author between honoring the warrior but not honoring war itself?
I think it's a really good question. And it's one that I've come to ask myself more and more as I get older. For this book, I stood on the very beach where Audie Murphy came ashore on the 10th of July, 1943, with, in that case, maybe 30 or 40 other Americans. I I went to Salerno. I went to Anzio. I stood on the very beach with my wife and son, both American, where Audie Murphy came ashore on the 15th of August, 1944, which is near Saint-Tropez, Operation Dragoon, most successful amphibious operation of World War II. And the beach is beautiful. I was there in January, and it's so gorgeous. It's like, you know, one of the most prized places you can find yourself if you're a Russian model or a Russian oligarch, or used to be anyway, bad joke, in Europe. So beautiful. And then I went to Besançon, where Robert Maxwell performed his acts. And I followed the Rhone up to Siegelsheim, just on the German border. I stood in the vineyard where Ware basically grabbed a BAR and risked his life for about an hour, making sure that his men got the job done when they were too terrified to even lift their heads above the ground. And I went to Nuremberg, and I stood by the medieval wall where I went to Holzfehr, obviously, which is where Audie Murphy received the performed acts for which he received the Medal of Honor. Stood not far from where the tank was that upon which he'd stood for over an hour as it burned. And then I went all the way to Nuremberg, and I stood by the medieval wall where on the 18th of April, 1945, Michael Daly dared to put his head above this medieval wall, the very heart of the heart of darkness, and was shot through the head. And I walked away from the street corner in Nuremberg, and I walked around the corner, and I cried for quite a while. And I realized that I hadn't even started in North Africa. I'd gone most of the way, but not started in North Africa. And I thought to myself, every stream, every village, every field, every street corner has to be taken. And the immense heroism, when you actually go and look at the battlefield and you look at what needs to be done, when you see how far it was, when you travel that journey, it takes you a long time and you're not being shot at. And I just was in absolute awe. And this is not me being cliched. I was in absolute awe of what it took to even survive an hour of that, let alone a day, let alone from November 1942 all the way to the end of the war. And you have to remember that Audie Murphy and Keith Ware went all the way from Sicily to the very end of the war. That's an epic ordeal. The trauma is unimaginable. It's something that to me seems superhuman. So, yeah, I think there's been a lot of glamorization of war. I've always tried not to. I think most people would say that I've tried to do the opposite, but I've never been in a war. I don't want to be in a war. I don't know what it's like to see people die around you. I don't know what that kind of trauma is like. So I think I've always been driven by the sense of immense respect for anybody that's prepared to put on a uniform and die for their country. And above all, anybody that put on a uniform, whether they liked it or not, in World War II and died so that I could grow up in freedom. I'm 56 years old, and I consider myself a European, and what was given to me was the most beautiful gift in human history. 56 years of peace and democracy, mostly. And it was a beautiful, beautiful time to grow up as a European, and a hell of a lot of working class Americans died there so that I could be here talking to you today.
Yeah. And it's great perspective. And Alex, I can really relate, because it's when you get a sense on these battlefields, or when you study these stories in the depth that we have, you really get a sense of what the war cost. And I think it really has sort of taken me away. I've always been away from this, but the sort of determinism about Allied victory, that it was inevitable. It wasn't. It took a lot of people fighting these kinds of battles. And as you said, in the case of these folks, across enormous distances, as fugitives from the law of averages. And I think that that sometimes it just gets lost in this sort of bird's eye view of the war. And so I really like how you brought that to light, you know, and I kind of wonder, you know, these four men were really kind of unusual among Medal of Honor recipients in that they all survived. You know, I mean, at least half of Medal of Honor recipients tend to be posthumous. So I wondered if you could sort of delve into their, you know, their very significant post-war trials and tribulations, what that was like for these guys, how they went on with the rest of their lives.
Well, I find it amazing that they were so functional, to be honest. All of them went on to make significant contributions either to, you know, their community or politics or, I mean, Audie Murphy made over 30 movies, had very, very serious PTSD. How could you not have very serious PTSD, very troubled character, chronic gambler towards the end of his life, troubled in his first marriage. And yet he made a lot of movies, was whenever he was asked to turn up and represent the US military, he did with great pride and did so with great honor. They all gave a lot and all were productive and not only had families, but also served their communities in different ways. Michael Daly in particular, I believe, spent an awful long time helping World War II veterans and serving a local hospital that he said that kind of commitment to others, that service to others, was what he'd been looking for all his life since World War II. He was looking for a cause greater than self, greater than his own ego, greater than the paycheck, and he found it by helping other people. So I was in awe of how functional they were, or rather how well they hid the damage. And I say this is the thing that one of the things that I always come back to when we talk about the so-called greatest generation. Remember, that's a title of a book. It's a marketing term. Whether you believe they were the greatest or not is another matter. I would like to think that my son belongs to a great generation too. But what was really great about them, I believe, among the survivors anyway, was that they came back and they built America. They never put the war behind them. I don't believe I've ever met April, you've met many D-Day veterans from this community. You probably know the cost of D-Day intimately more than anybody I know anyway, because you spent your life feeling that emotion, seeing what they've done for this community, seeing how well they adjusted or didn't adjust. But I've always been completely bowled over by how they never put the war behind them, but they put it to the side and then gave a lot and literally built the under threat modern middle American class, built America, came back, didn't bitch, didn't moan, didn't talk about it, certainly not with their families, and just got on with life. And that's a hell of a lot of people that were psychologically profoundly scarred, let alone physically wounded. But I've always been just like, you know, I think that one of the sisters, the Parker sister in the Bedford Boys, in the his brother, I think, Clyde, April, you can correct me here. I think Clyde had been killed on Omaha Beach, and Jack Powers came back. And then he went, before he came home to Bedford County, he went to Richmond, Virginia, to a hospital where his sister was, because he couldn't bear to come home without her. He didn't want to face his folks without her. And when I was researching, I interviewed her, and she said that she thought it was the guys that came home and had to live with it for the rest of their lives who were the greatest heroes. So I'm going on too long, but I think that immense buckle up, knuckle down, get on with life is something that I just have enormous respect for.
Well, I think you're right. And you so many of them that we've known throughout our lifetime. One of the questions I'll always ask a World War II veteran is what do you want us to learn from you? What do we take away? What do we need to tell others? And it seems like it always comes back to service, giving back. I hear that and have heard that throughout my years. And I think you're right. I think that's what we see in these men who did, like you said, put it aside. And is that what you see as kind of these lessons? What do we learn from these men that they've told you over the years?
Well, I think that certainly in the case of the guys that I write about, there's something almost supernatural about them, in the sense that they had no right to live. There was no, you know, John put it earlier on, against, they were fugitives against the law of averages. And that's how Audie Murphy described himself, as a fugitive against the laws of averages. So they were, it was miraculous that they lived. And I think there's something very special about the fact that they did live. And whether it was survivor's guilt that drove them to try and give back, I don't know. But I think there was a large element to having gone through those ordeals and lost so many friends, seen so many people die. I do think there's this compulsion to give back, because there's an awful lot of people that aren't around that gave everything. And you're alive, you're breathing, and you can give back. So service, yes, service, absolutely, yeah.
And actually, I think it was Jack. I believe it was Jack Powers who died. Clyde was
the one that came back.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. Yes.
Thank you.
That's right. Yes.
I'm in dangerous waters here. No, you're not. At least I'm not on Omaha Beach on Dog Green Sector. But yeah, no, that's a good point. I can't remember the name of the sister now, but I should.
You know, one thing that really got my attention in the book, Alex, that stood out to me, because I'd sort of lived with Alexander Patch in a different context.
Yeah,
as the commander at Guadalcanal, you know, in doing a series about the Army in the Pacific. And I really liked how you know, in telling Michael Daly's story, you were sort of telling Patch's stories to some extent, too. And you had mentioned earlier with us today that there was a kind of element of tragedy about that. You know, I wonder if you could go into that a little more deeply about General Patch and, of course, what happened with his son and with the general, too.
Patch, as you know better than I do, had served in the Pacific and was brought to Europe. So I don't think there were many senior officers in World War II that served in both theaters, certainly not at the level that Patch eventually rose to. He had a son called Alex Ander Jr., and his son, I came across a photograph where they're photographed together, I think in the early fall of 1944, and his son was killed in October 1944, and it was his only son. So I only have one son, one child. It was his only child. And I can't imagine what that would feel like to be an army commander in some of the toughest fighting of World War II, and then to learn that your only, the thing that you love most, the person that you love most, has just been lost. And yet you have to carry on. You have to carry on under extraordinary pressure. I mean, these guys are aging. They're aging their lives out in a few years. You look at World War II generals in their 50s, and the stress is just extraordinary. Patch died at just after the war, I think less than a couple of years after the war. And I think that part of that was a broken heart from losing his son in combat in World War II. Very, very much admired by the men that served under him. There's a really beautiful memorial to him about 50 yards off the beach in Saint-Tropez that I visited. And I think he's one of the least appreciated American generals of World War II. Did a superb job, but wasn't a publicity hound, wasn't a Patton, wasn't a guy that wanted to be in the headlines, but did a superb job.
I think so too. And yeah. His letters to his wife are
heartbreaking,
fascinating, and so honest, you know.
Yeah.
And Alex, it reminded me too of what happened with Leslie McNair. Leslie McNair lost his son Doug, Colonel Doug McNair, who was chief of staff of the 77th Infantry Division under AD Bruce in the Battle of Guam. And this had happened, and then of course what almost immediately at the same time, it happened to Leslie McNair killed in Operation Cobra in the short bombing. So imagine his wife losing, you know, two people like that. And so Patch's story kind of reminded me of almost the same thing, you know. So, we're out of time for this segment. But I just wanted to thank you so much, Alex. The book, again, is called Against All Odds, A True Story of Ultimate Courage and Survival in World War II. I really appreciate you talking so eloquently today about it. It's been a fascinating discussion. Thank you so much.
Oh, my pleasure. It's great to finally see you on a screen. Other people can't see the screen, but I can. And John's just a fantastic historian. And thank you for talking today with me.
Absolutely. True pleasure, Alex. Thank you so much. John Long, how about our veteran of the segment?
Absolutely. Today in our We Salute You feature, we honor the service of D-Day veteran Charles Henry Neighbor. Chuck Neighbor was a Kansas native who was drafted to do his part and who ended up in Company E, 116th Regiment, 29th Division. In his wartime photos, he looked more like a bookworm fit for a classroom or a library than the battlefield. But make no mistake about it, on Omaha Beach on D-Day, Chuck had to be a warrior. Chuck's assignment on D-Day was to back up a fellow soldier operating a flamethrower. Picture the carnage on Omaha Beach. Now imagine enduring it with an 80-pound tank of flammable chemicals on your back, knowing you were one of the first men the Germans would target because of it. When his lead flamethrower man was hit, Chuck immediately took over. However, for reasons Chuck would never know, the flamethrower malfunctioned, and he never got to use it. Throwing that gear aside, he grabbed a rifle and became an infantryman. Chuck Neighbor survived D-Day, but the 29th Division's fight at Saint-Lô nearly got him. He got his first Purple Heart there. After recuperating, he returned to his unit to earn a second one. He finished his time in the Army and the occupation forces in Germany, a warrior who had won. After the war, Chuck became an engineer, eventually settling in Virginia to raise a family. Years later, he worked with his friend Bob Slaughter to get the National D-Day Memorial built, and Chuck attended many events here. Compelled to tell his story and keep his buddy's memories alive, he wrote a wartime biography called One Man's War Story. On the 75th anniversary of D-Day, no less than the Vice President of the United States quoted Chuck as an authority on what it was like on those beaches that day. Sadly, Chuck Neighbor passed away last month at the age of 97. One of the last D-Day veterans of the storied 116th Regiment. Chuck is gone, but his story lives on here at the National D-Day Memorial. Chuck Neighbor, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
We will miss Chuck. He was amazing. He never missed a ceremony. He made sure he was always June 6th. You would see him right in the front row. We always honored him. He was amazing. And his book is fantastic if you get the opportunity to read it if you haven't. And I can remember one thing that stands out to you. He would always talk about how lonely those holidays were. I can remember he said Christmas was just so tough. You know, those songs would come over. He'd listen on radio and how those soldiers wanted to be home. So we will miss Chuck a great deal.
Folks like that will never be replaced.
No, definitely not. Absolutely.
So special to us. Well, in our next episode, Alex Kershaw is gracious enough to join us again. And this time the topic will be his remarkable book, The Bedford Boys, which obviously is a story near and dear to our hearts at the National D-Day Memorial. So that'll be in our next episode. In the meantime, if you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, subscribe to this podcast, share with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II with a larger audience.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial. Plan your visit and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org.
Simply change the conversation.
Let's just talk about love, cause that's what I'm thinking of. And
it's no military secret that I love you.
About romancing,
if you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I want to give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change.